French on video.
Yeah, we'll speak French or English. Would you like to speak?
I can speak in English. It's okay.
Okay, this is someone whom I think of as a hero, one of my heroes, Pierre le Corf, definitely a hero of mine. I'm pleased to, honored to be with him today. We met him by chance in Aleppo. Thank you very much for speaking with us, Pierre.
My pleasure.
And I appreciate your work so much. It's, you're a saint in many ways. Could you tell us how life has changed in Aleppo since the liberation?
I mean, it has been very different steps because during the war we were besieged by the terrorists. So the media used to talk about the army besieging the terrorists, but actually we were besieged first. The army moved around the terrorists and besieged the terrorists back. So for like a big period of time, really we thought that Aleppo will never be liberated. And we really thought that Aleppo will fall because they were attacking by thousands and thousands. And it was really, really hard because the neighborhood I was living was like really frontline, and we can hear like the terrorists screaming Allahu Akbar, and we can hear them and singing even. So we, like for a few months, we spent time like with our clothes the night with the bags, and it was really warm because we were like, really thinking that we have to run overnight. So step by step, the Russians moved on much more on Aleppo, and so they really. They kind of saved the situation because they were attacking really by thousands sometimes, and the only one way when we didn't get in is that the planes were taking care of the second and the third waves of the ones coming. And but we were shelled much more the time was passing, more we shelled, and here it was like still hell, all the street everyone was bombed, like not every day but nearly everything after in my neighborhood was like 25 mortars a day, well, that's just my neighborhood, which was like
they were targeting civilians, the terrorists,
yes,
were targeting civilians.
Anybody, they didn't target anything specifically because they use mortars and they use gas bottle rockets. There's no way to target any specific target. They just choose the degree of launching and it goes. And in function of like the repercussions in the media here and everything, they target other places on the same. The purpose is to kill people.
I heard they killed maybe 11,000 civilians.
It's around 12 to 13,000 now.
Civilians. And they crippled and wounded another a large number as
well.
Yeah,
there's around 40,000 people.
Yeah.
Here it has been very, very tough because most of, I can tell you, I just come back from the school and we were talking with the children and we're trying to make the difference between now and before. And still today, the big problem is that most of them, they were ready to die. Most of my children in the
really?
School.
Really? How old are they?
I had them between 12 to 17 years old. So I have from the 7th grade to the 11th grade.
Yeah.
And most of them, they were ready to die. And actually, the situation now is getting much better. Everything is really good because we are not bombed anymore here. A little bit sometimes. But most of the neighborhoods are still bombed around the city. But here, it's okay. And this is even worse for the youth. Why? Because before, they were ready to die.
Yeah.
And they were condemned to die.
Yeah.
Now they are condemned to leave, which is much worse than before, because before they really had Now they're condemned to leave. Before they were condemned to die.
To live.
That was fine. Living is harder. So
why? Tell me, why is living harder now?
Because before they could just, how can I say, being here, leave, being under the circumstance of war and everything, but how can I say, now they have the same situation as before, but without the possibility to escape. So the death, it was really fine. The only one thing was, which was really scary in the youth here, was to be crippled.
Yeah.
And this was like the fear of everybody, or to lose somebody you love. But now I can say the situation is much better. The economy is coming a little bit back, but the sanctions and everything are slowing the country down.
Okay, so the kids are afraid to live. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, because now they have to be here without a job, without opportunity in the future.
No job, no opportunity.
They don't see. There is
they don't see.
In their mind, with the vision they have of the war with their with the parents, the fathers, the grandfathers, whatever, they don't expect anything from the future. They struggle. The only one way they see that they can have something eventually would be to travel somewhere else out of the country. Here in Syria, they don't see it because they just see that like 2 kilometers from here, we're still besieged by terrorists in the path to see.
So they don't see a future.
Now they struggle. They have dreams. All of them, they have
bad
dreams.
Bad dreams, trauma.
They have. No, they have. They had it also, but Jenny, they have, how can I say?
Ambitions.
They have ambitions. They will see themselves, but in the same time, they struggle to imagine that this is possible. Their self-confidence is down.
A lot of psychological, spiritual trauma.
And the work we do with the children.
Is that the work you're doing? You're trying to help them with everything?
For the work with the children, yes, it's about emotional guidance. So it's to help them to keep the things important, to erase what's useless, and to put the finger where it hurts, to deal with the things that they try to erase and which are like deeply rotting inside.
Yes. Is it correct that in terrorist-occupied areas, the kids do not go to school?
No, of course they don't.
They don't go to school?
They don't go to school. Actually, most of the schools are used by the military because the management of the schools are perfect. It's underground.
Oh, you mean the terrorists, they take over the schools?
Yes. Yeah. And the schools are, say, if they use sometime by some association or whatever, it's like a school mostly based on the religion.
Yeah. We were talking about that the other day, that one of the first things they attacked was education because the terrorists, because they don't want an educated population. They
stole everything from the people, more than their home, more than they stole their hope, they stole their life, they stole everything they can eventually, anybody can imagine to have on them. So the thing is that they, and you can see in the East still today, the people, they're coming back, all the children, they're just so happy to be in the school because they didn't have the chance to be with other youth except in the streets. Like, but then most of them, they stay inside because of course they were the planes, they were the terrorists. So it was really dangerous, and the situation was worse because they couldn't have any way to escape. They were stuck there because the terrorists kept them there. They were really used as human shields, and most of the people are saying that human shield is like a, how can I say, is a term which is used by the Syrian government, but which is not. They were used by human shield as they were used in Douma, as they were used in Kota, as they're still used in lots of places.
Yeah.
And the fact is that the same now is going with Idlib, and it will happen the same. Idlib will be the next step for the army and the next step for the terrorists. Maybe even we will have a new chemical attack in Idlib. And I hope not, because it will be so big. I don't know. I don't understand how people can still build it.
Yeah, and what do you think about that chemical attack? Pearson Sharp was there. He saw nothing. I wrote an article about it. I don't think anything happened. I think it was strictly false flag.
If it happened, if like the bodies were staged, and there were bodies which were killed by anyway, or if it was real and that these people died from chlorine, certainly not. It's not the governance of Syria or Libya. We have no purpose. I'll tell you one thing, and this is something like very, very logical for us here and in the war, and when we see the planes and when we see the bombings from the side or on us. And if the army had ways to kill 100 times much more people than using any barrel of chlorine, they have cluster bombs, they've dropped 2 cluster bombs, they can kill if they want like 500 people. It's easy.
It's pretty obvious. For people living here, it must be pretty obvious.
And the people, the purpose of the Syrian government and the Russian is not to kill the people, but the people are stuck in military places. And the problem is really hard for a lot of people today to imagine that, about after everything we heard on television, after everything we heard on the radio, so you have to imagine that what I'm saying today can be really real. I mean, I'm saying that for sure the terrorists used the chlorine. I found chlorine at the liberation here. And my government, I read the intelligence report of my government, and they're saying we have no proof that the terrorists even used or got once in the chlorine. Of course they had. They had 100 kilos marked by Saudi Arabia here in Aleppo.
Right.
I mean, this is everything. The truth doesn't matter anymore. This is really on purpose to build a pretext, or eventually to show that the international community doesn't stay apart from the conflict, or eventually to make a new stage on the war.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
I heard you telling about a new stage in the war on your videos. What are you afraid about?
My pleasure.
What do you think could happen?
Yeah. I can't guess. It's really hard, but I can tell you that I am sure that today the was a step. Aleppo will be the next one because they can't. Aleppo is the biggest amount of terrorists you can find ever in Syria. You have all the activists, pro-Islamic activists, and when I say Islam, it's something important. I mean, more pro-Islamic in the Islam way, because they are not Muslims. They're using the pretext of religions, and they, most of them don't know anything about the religion. So they're using this pretext as a kind of religion, Wahhabi or Salafi, so Wahhabi is especially from Saudi Arabia, Salafi more from Qatar or Turkey. And this is like a religious mindset which is about using the precept of the very old Quran, but as today. So for example, if it's written that an 8-year-old girl should not go to school, they believe in it. They don't make the interpretation, you know, they use the pretext of the religion to do whatever they want. The same, you can go in the East Aleppo here, it's written on the wall, you know, you can find the Quran, Surah, you can find Hadith, the discussion with the Prophet, but which are cut in pieces and they just connect everything together and they do whatever they want with that. So for me, the future will be based, mainly based on a huge group of terrorists and activists who are now in Idlib and also connected to Turkey now, who may be able to make something big. I hope not, and I think people now, they learned a little bit, but I think that it's really possible that something happened. And anyway, Idlib will be a big step, because now all the terrorists who were in Syria everywhere, now they're in Idlib, all of them. And this represents, I don't know, I can't tell you a number, but I know that we send them by dozens of thousands. So you can't, it would be a very hard place. Or eventually the government will do nothing and they will keep them on the side of the country there, or they will move on it. We don't know. But anyway, something will happen, and I think this, you know, this area needs to be liberated because there's still a lot of people living there. And
that's it. There. Who suffer.
And there's much less than other places, but a lot of them. A lot. Yeah. Because the area is so huge.
Can I just ask you a media question?
Yes.
It's reported by our corporate media that as the fall of Aleppo, as you know, the fall of Aleppo rather than the liberation. Do the people in Aleppo know that's how it's being reported? And if they do, what do they say about that?
The people, most of the people, except the people who are well connected, who have functions here which make them connected to the foreigner media, they don't search more about how the Westerns are thinking. Mm. Even they're surprised sometimes. Some of them, they didn't really search or know about what's happening from outside on their country.
Yeah.
They just see what's happening from inside. But the people here, of course, they believe. You can ask anybody, do you think that Aleppo fell?
Mm.
No, of course not.
Yeah.
100% here will tell you, because if Aleppo was gonna fall, we will be dead, or we will be occupied, and this will be the black flag. These restaurants will be closed, the school will be closed, everything will be closed. And everything will be under bombings, under destruction.
Yeah. And they're very quiet now about Aleppo.
Yes. And all this, 60% of the area of Aleppo, which is now safe.
Yeah.
40% which is still bombed.
Yeah.
And the big part of it in the periphery, which are still occupied by the terrorists in Zahra.
But our media now, they never mention Aleppo now because it doesn't fit the narrative.
Because they lost.
Yeah.
They lost in Aleppo. The media lost in Aleppo.
Yes.
It was like a huge business model for everybody, and everybody fought very hard to make and to keep their, let's say, their meal coming every day on their table by continuously using the reports on Aleppo and everything. Aleppo was like a business model for people. Now, Aleppo is a kind of shame for a lot of people. Now, people forget it.
Absolutely.
And they go away and to another place where they can progress and make something better, more sharp.
Mm.
So,
can I just ask you one question about your animal sanctuary? I'm a vegan animal rights activist as well as a human rights activist. So just so that I can report back to animal groups in the UK, some people might say, in the midst of all this human suffering, why did you feel it was important to care about the animals?
And if animals were dying at the same time as humans were dying here, the fact is that human beings believe that it holds the planet, but it doesn't really. We're sharing this common space. In our education, we learn a kind of anti-specism education, which is like the humans are, the animals are kind of decoration here in our planet. So the thing is that animals and humans are not different. And when I love animals from my part, and I learn a lot from them. But also when I saw sometimes many people dying, I also remember two times when I saw like animals dead and ones which were running in fire because of the fall of a rocket. And then I saw a lot of animals dying, and we have lots of injured animals from shrapnels or cars or whatever. But life stays alive. And whoever you are, whatever you're thinking, you're atheist, or whatever you're thinking, you're Muslim or Jewish or Muslim, it's written. It's written in the Bible, in the Quran, in the Torah. It's written everywhere that you have to take care of any kind of species. Especially from the moment that you believe that you're a superior species.
Yes.
So from any kind of superior species, you need to take care of the wicked species.
Yes.
So this is something which is important, whatever people believe that or not. I believe that I am equal with any kind of animal. Mm. This is something that people here in Syria doesn't prove with, because the relationship with animal is not the same as in Europe. But a lot of people care because... But a lot of people are scared because they don't know, because they never get educated in this stuff. And life matters, whatever it's true or without.
Oh, that's wonderful. Wonderful philosophy. I share that philosophy. Thank you very much.
My pleasure.
Thank you.